Morning, everyone. My name is David Abel. I'm the State Department Chair here at Marine Corps University. This morning we're going to have insights from three people who know much more about Iran than I do. Let me tell you that Hussein Banai, who will be speaking to us first, is an assistant professor in the Department of International Studies at Indiana University. He's also a research affiliate at the Center for International Studies at MIT, and is a contributor to Becoming Enemies, a new book about the U.S.-Iran relations. We're also will be hearing today from Alex Vatanka, who specializes in Middle East regional security affairs with a focus on Iran. He's worked variously for Jane's Islamic Affairs in London, and he's also a senior fellow in Middle East Studies at the U.S. Air Force Special Operations School down at Hurlburt Field. And Amin Tarzi, whom we all know, is here at Marine Corps University. He supports MCU by providing a present resident scholar with expertise in Middle East and South Central Asia. Also, Alex Vatanka, I should have mentioned, is the author of Iran and Pakistan, another new book on security, diplomacy, and American influence in that bilateral relationship. What we're going to try to do this morning is spend about 25 minutes with each of these gentlemen. Then we'll give them an opportunity to, and then we'll take a break. Then we'll give each of them a few minutes to comment on what the other two fellows have said. Then we'll throw it open for discussion. So with that, Dr. Banai.
Thank you very much. Is it okay if I sit and talk? I don't know if this works. Okay. There we go. Well, good morning. It's wonderful to be here. I want to thank Dr. Tarzi for the invitation and the Middle East Center to have me out here. And thank you all for coming in this morning. Some of you may have stayed up late watching the game. There are more smiles than grimaces, so I don't know which way you were going rooting for. Being from IU, I'm just a sad person on the sidelines watching these things. There's quite a bit to cover. I was asked to speak broadly in terms of Iran's regional relations after the joint comprehensive plan of action, the nuclear deal between Iran and the P5+1, the effect that deal might have had on Iran's relations in the region. And the reactions to it from other regional countries. When I was thinking about what I might say that might shed some light beyond the torrent of news headlines that no doubt you've kept up with or you have no other chance but to be exposed to, given how much of that is in the news, the first thought that occurred to me was that actually very little has changed since the signing of the nuclear deal in terms of Iran's relations in the region, and especially in terms of Iran's policies in the region. Some had worried that the nuclear deal would embolden Iran to become more assertive in the region, while there are some indications that, especially vis-a-vis Syria, Iran's Revolutionary Guards have been more assertive, more actively involved in providing support, material support, to the Assad regime. I think given the course of the Syrian war, that would have happened no matter what had happened with the nuclear deal. In fact, had that nuclear deal fell through, I think Iran would feel especially compelled to double down in Syria and back Assad. And they have a long history of that stretches back to Bashar al-Assad's father, Hafez al-Assad, of supporting the Syrian regime. So in Syria, I think there's a great deal of continuity that one can trace from prior to the signing of the nuclear agreement to the after. I'll go just go through the list of some countries and then I'll tease out the nuance. With respect to Iraq, Iran's role in Iraq, again, very consistent with the line of policy Iran had adopted after the invasion of Iraq, which is to make sure that Shia militias, and especially the Shia-led government of Iraq, is fortified, is very much within the sphere of influence of Iran. The nuclear deal did not have a pronounced effect on how Iran might go, whether it became more receptive to maybe other parties in Iraq being as part of a power sharing. Iran had always basically had the same policy toward Iraq, which was to safeguard its interests and to make sure that those who are sympathetic to Iran's line of thinking were very much at the top of the pecking order in Iraqi politics. And that has continued unabated as well. A major change, you could say, has occurred in terms of the proxy war with Saudi Arabia, a mini Cold War, some have called it, that has been brewing for some time between Iran and Saudi Arabia, that again has its roots in longstanding material and non-material differences between the Saudi royal family and the House of Saud and the Islamic Republic. But this has clearly escalated in places like Yemen in terms of support of non-state groups in Syria, in Iraq, and especially in terms of the diplomacy each side has carried with outside powers, especially the Europeans and the United States. It's no secret that the Saudis were very much worried about Iran, Iran's growing influence in the region, not just after the invasion of Iraq, but especially since the advent of the Arab Spring in late 2010, early 2011, which saw a lot of major Arab countries being weakened, which played right into the hands of Iran's growing influence in the region, or in fact, very much fortified that growth. So there were some talks of Iranian hegemony being on the rise and this coming at the expense of the Saudis. I think there's clear evidence that this has been very much at the forefront of the strategic thinking of both the Saudis and the Iranians. And if you just listen or watch or read the transcripts of the speeches given by senior commanders of the Iran's Revolutionary Guards, but also senior members of the Saudi royal family, it's becoming increasingly clear that both sides very much see themselves locked in a zero-sum game in terms of influence in the region. The one, I think, relationship that has become more intensely it has become a more intense conflict in the region is this proxy war between Saudi Arabia and Iran. Yemen here, the civil war, the festering civil war in Yemen is basically a very exemplary theater for how this war has been played out. The Saudis doubled down in pushing back the Houthi rebels that were supported by Iran to a great extent. Iran backed away somewhat, really didn't have that much of an investment in Yemen. But that was more because they had always regarded Yemen as basically a distraction away from their real interest in Syria and in stabilizing parts of Western Iraq, which had been lost to ISIS. Speaking of ISIS, I think the after the nuclear deal, there was some hope that perhaps Iran would join an informal coalition fighting ISIS, take more coordinated action alongside U.S. allies in the region in pushing back ISIS. To the extent that I've been able to observe, Iran has been very adamant that it is carrying out its own anti ISIL operations, that it's not coordinated with any particular power. But when you hear anecdotes or you read testimonies of certain commanders, you find that there may be a great deal of communication on the battlefield taking place in terms of coordinating attacks and what have you with other countries. Iran's now kind of almost mythical commander, General Qasem Soleimani of its Quds force, elite Quds force in Iraq and in Syria, has popped up in close proximity of many other and some U.S. military advisors in Iraq and in parts of Syria. And this has led to speculation that he's been there secretly negotiating some sort of understanding in terms of takeover of particular areas, pushing back ISIL influence and what have you. Again, these are things that people like me have to wait for another 10 or 15 years to really be able to debrief people and get their oral histories on exactly what was happening, which is largely what the content of the book that you very kindly held up. But we won't know in the moment just what the extent of cooperation is between Iran and other countries in terms of anti-ISIL operations. Going back to some of the key elements here, I think the reason for the continuity between Iran's actions after the nuclear deal has to do with this sort of careful balancing act that Iranian leaders have had to play between the national interest of the country, the ethno-cultural identity, Persian identity of the nation, but also this increasingly sectarian identity of Iran as a major Shia power and a guardian of Shia minorities in Sunni-dominated Arab lands. That's been a consistent worry of Iranian policymakers. I'm not entirely sure that actually they're entirely happy with this latter day position they've been put in that they've now become the guardians of the Shia in the region, and now they have to kind of figure out and assert their interests. But it's very clear that there's a great deal of tension between the foreign ministry in Iran, between the commander of the Revolutionary Guards, between the supreme leader, in terms of what exactly should guide Iran's strategic actions in the region. There's hardly any coherent or even public statements coming out of the foreign ministry in terms of Iran's foreign policy objectives in Syria, in Iraq, and to a lesser extent vis-a-vis the Saudis. There's a very good reason for that. It's because the foreign ministry is fully made up of diplomats. Most of them are Western educated, who have a purely an Iran-centered view of the national interest, meaning that for them, the ethnocultural and the sectarian identity of the regime are of secondary importance. And they're very mindful of that. A lot of it harkens back to their education. A lot of them are kind of realist orientation. But also they see it that over the course of the last 37 years since the Islamic Revolution, Iran has lost a great deal of its human capital to Western countries, precisely because it hasn't had very, very good economic relations with outside countries, especially Western countries. So the foreign ministry, since the nuclear deal, had felt especially emboldened to argue for a robust return to Iran's core national interests, which is engagement with Western powers, seizing that opportunity, but also with regional countries within reason. With respect to Saudi Arabia, they have become I would say, especially nationalistic in tone. Even the foreign ministry has been rather undiplomatic in terms of how they addressed Saudi statements about Iranian leaders or about what Iran should be allowed to do, et cetera. Really quite remarkable and unprecedented set of commentary coming out of the usually very diplomatic foreign ministry. For the Revolutionary Guards, the wars in Syria and in Iraq are entirely viewed through the lens of not exporting the revolution, but preserving and fortifying the revolutionary ideals of the Islamic Republic, which they view increasingly as having been given up on by these sort of wily diplomats and people who have grown soft. There's virtually no daylight on some of the key strategic interests in the region between perhaps the supreme leader and some people in the foreign ministry. But when you talk to some of these Revolutionary Guard commanders, or you read what they tweet and where they're photographed on Instagram, a lot of them have Instagram accounts, and they daily post a barrage of photos from the battlefields in Syria and in Iraq. And you read the captions, it's all almost a kind of a set of snarky commentary directed against the would-be pragmatists or pragmatists in the foreign ministry or in the president's office. So you have this kind of division, this tripartite division of Iran's strategic interests that is being played out through different organs of government. And I think since the signing of the nuclear deal, each of these levers of power has worried about what it might lose with respect to the other. So the Revolutionary Guards have doubled down in places like Syria and Iraq, sometimes undermined the diplomacy carried out by the foreign ministry in order to make sure that the post JCPOA environment is one that doesn't compromise Iran's core revolutionary interests. The foreign ministry has tried to exploit whatever diplomatic leverage it has gained as a result of that deal to get the public and the nation behind a more Iran-focused set of objectives. And you have the supreme leader who basically has played a balancing role, trying to at one point, if one side is getting a little too carried away, to bring him down to earth, as it were, but at other times to make sure that his position and the position of the clerical elite is not undermined, to come out and explicitly broadcast fairly anti-diplomatic, anti-Western set of invectives. So what we have here, I think, in terms of Iran's regional politics or regional relations since the signing of the nuclear deal, is actually a fairly continuous set of worries that Iran had prior to the signing of the nuclear deal. They have become intensified with respect to countries that have also viewed Iran's growing role as problematic, like Saudi Arabia. But in other instances, given the power vacuum in the region, more generally, Iran has kind of managed the status quo in a way that would be advantageous to its at least short-term goals, strategic goals going forward. How all this will shake out is unclear to me, because we've had a fairly passive Western involvement in mediating these new dynamics in the region. The new administration will have a different outcome, or have a different outlook than the current one. And so we'll see whether there being a kind of a more more of a proactive American policy line in the region will have an effect on Iran's behavior, and whether Iran will pull back and it will, or in fact double down. One last thing I'll say is not until the entrance of Russia and Russian support in Syria did Iran's role in Syria start to look good for the Revolutionary Guards inside Iran. In fact, in the immediate aftermath of the signing of the nuclear deal, there was a great deal of chatter inside Iran that because of the successes of the diplomacy that was carried out by the Foreign Minister Javad Zarif and the President Hassan Rouhani, that Iran should now basically draw back its influence in Syria. Bashar al-Assad looked like a kind of a lost cause at that point. It was, the regime was very much on its heels. And then the Russians came in and basically fortified Assad, and that enabled the Revolutionary Guard to kind of play second fiddle. They no longer were seen as the major backers of the Assad regime. And that took off the heat to a great extent off the Revolutionary Guards and their activities inside Syria. And the spotlight basically shifted back to what Iran was getting specifically out of the nuclear deal, whether the money was going to be frozen entirely, with all the sanctions that had been promised to be lifted or being lifted, et cetera. More kind of technocratic, more micro-level discussions about the post-nuclear deal outcomes. So the entrance of Russia into that theater could not be, I think, overstated in terms of the out it gave the Revolutionary Guards in Syria. And going forward, I think one has to be mindful of once the Russians leave, you know, just what legacy they leave behind in terms of Iran's growing influence in the so-called Shia crescent, stretching from Herat and parts of Western Afghanistan all the way to the shores of the Mediterranean. So that wild card that I think was unforeseen at the time of the signing of the nuclear deal is something that has to be contemplated. Let me leave it there. I'm close to my time limit, and I'll pass it on to you.
Thank you.
Good morning. It's great to be back. I'm going to miss Sebastian Gorka, who used to sit in the back, but now he's on Fox News, I hear. So that's great. I'm going to follow up in many ways on the same kind of topics that Hussein just mentioned. What I'm going to do is to sort of take you back a bit more historically into some of these issues. I hope you don't mind. And actually, one of the things that I will not be speaking so much about, but I look forward to get into in the Q&A with you, is on a point that Hussein mentioned, the future of US policy in the Middle East. What would a more assertive American policy do to Iranian calculations? My quick answer to that is probably a heck of a lot. These are not suicidal people. They do basic cost-benefit analysis. My last conversation yesterday before I left the office was a journalist who called and said, who would be advising President Trump if what happened yesterday with the US Navy firing off warning shots against incoming IRGC naval vessels, who ought to be and what will the message be to President Trump in terms of what to do if that happened on his watch? And to just keep it close to home for you, I said, well, he doesn't have to look far. He's got General Mattis right there, a man who I have had the pleasure to brief and I respect and is one of yours. And he's going to be running the DOD. And people tell me that Marine Corps is taking over the leadership of the United States military. I don't know if this is true. You tell me that. But General Mattis, certainly you have someone who's known the region for a very long time and knows the Iranian issue very well. I mean, he knows the splits within the Islamic Republic. He does not have a simple view on how the Islamic Republic operates, and he has very much a historic view on how this entity called the Islamic Republic operates at home and in the region. I won't get into General Mattis so much, but I wanted to focus more on the issue of, let's see if I can figure out the technology. Okay. Really, what I wanted to talk about, again, to many of the points that Hussein was referring to, I wanted to talk about Iran's power structure. And in that sense, I want to focus on one of those entities, and that's what we call the Islamic Revolution Guards Corps. In the United States, a lot of journalists take the lazy option out, call it the Revolutionary Guards. That's not its name. It's called the Islamic Revolution Guards Corps. And it means a lot, because it means they're there to defend the outcome of one revolution, the outcome of the 1979 revolution. They're there as the political watchguards of the regime. They crack down at home on anybody that stands up and faces the Supreme Leader Ali Khamenei. But increasingly, what we've seen in recent years, and that's largely what I will be focusing on, they're taking that same method to the region. And from a US strategic point of view, that's bad news, and that needs to be countered. Because if you don't like what they have done at home, you're going to see what they're doing elsewhere in the region. Again, from a US strategic point of view, if you take the long-term perspective, that is not good news. Okay. Look, I wanted to throw this one out because this is something that really deserves to be debated. When you're sitting here in Washington trying to figure out what is your policy, one of the first questions you have to ask is, what leverage do I have? Are you one of those people who believes in good mullahs versus bad mullahs, the way Madeleine Albright used to talk about it? Or in many ways, the way the last 8 years of the Obama administration has framed the Iran question? Or do you just say, no, they're all mullahs. They all have to go. I don't distinguish between the moderate Rouhani versus the hardliner Khamenei. And that's fine. And pity me as an Iran watcher who's been doing this for the last 20 years, I do see nuances. Again, I think a lot of the things that Hussein was talking about are about those nuances. There are splits, cracks within the Islamic Republic, but it's intellectually a very fair question to ask, does it matter for what the US cares about, which is mostly about Iranian behavior in the region? Do those differences within the regime matter from a Washington's perspective? And I would say to a large extent, it does. So here is my simple division of power in the Islamic Republic. I think if you want to keep life easy for yourselves, focus on three components that really make up the leadership of the Islamic Republic. You got the office of the Supreme Leader, that's the unelected fellow by the name of Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, not to be confused by the founding father, Ayatollah Khomeini. Even for us Persian speakers, it's tough. We get confused, Khomeini, Khamenei, but they're two different men. One died back in 1989. Then you got the office of the presidency, that's led by Hassan Rouhani, and he's up for re-election in May of this year. And you got the IRGC, the Islamic Revolution Guards Corps. You know, this morning when I woke up, I was following the news coming out of Iran, and I was interested to hear that they were chanting again in the streets of Tehran, death to Russia, death to Russia. What are they talking about, death to Russia? Well, if you're an Iranian moderate reformist today, you see Vladimir Putin as an enabler of the Islamic Republic hardliners. He wants the hardliners in Iran to have the upper hand. Russia does not want to see US have any kind of real meaningful dialogue with the United States. From Russia's perspective, that's bad. Russia looks at Iran as the prized real estate in the Middle East. You have Iran, you have your fingers everywhere else in the region. Let the United States have the Gulf Arab states. They're fine, they're great allies as long as they buy American arms and have oil to sell, but one day that's gonna all dry up. Iran's gonna stay. And by the way, that's exactly how the Chinese look at Iran as well. Look at China's infrastructure projects that they've come up with the last few years. Iran is at the heart of it when it comes to the Middle East, all the way. The most recent one is the 2013 One Road, One Belt project. allegedly $1 trillion Chinese project to link up China with Europe, and a lot of that, the corridors are going through Iran. Death to Russia, they're saying. And that was, last time they said death to Russia was in 2009, when the Green Opposition was cracked out. But when they're saying death to Russia, a lot of it's genuinely meant to highlight the fact that the Russian Federation today is helping Iranian intelligence and security and military services in many different ways. Some of it we see in Syria. What we don't see is what the Russians are helping the hardliners do in Iran to crack down on the Iranian opposition. That we don't read so much in the Washington Post, but that's happening. And that's what the Iranian reformers care about. Okay? So, in many ways, we have here in the Islamic Republic a power struggle, and it is a real power struggle for political control. Death to Russia, the protest this morning in Tehran, the reason why that was allowed to happen was because people were in the streets to mourn the death of one of the founding fathers of the Republic, a man by the name of Ayatollah Ali Akbar Hashemi Rafsanjani. Mouthful of a name, but he was around for a long time. Two-time former president, influential player. His network today is basically what you have sit in the presidential palace. Right from Rouhani down, these are all the students of the old man who just died on Sunday. He dies. The reformists in Iran don't have the godfather they've had for so long. What's going to happen to them? The IRGC guys are waiting on the sidelines to bring them all down, to go in and totally neutralize the so-called Rafsanjani network. And that is one real serious development for us to watch. On top of that, the supreme leader is 77 years old. He was the one we were all watching to see if he's going to die. He just had cancer treatment. But it was his rival, Rafsanjani, who passed on first, 5 years senior to Khamenei. But Khamenei, at least in the perspective of Iranians who are sitting there trying to figure out what they ought to do next to maintain as much power as possible, is on his way out too. What does this do? This intensifies the struggle for jockeying for power. You want to be in the right place when Khamenei dies. Okay. Why did Rafsanjani, this fellow, this is the man I'm talking about who died on Sunday. I mean, he was hardly a softy, right? He was one of those guys who basically engineered the taking over of the U.S. Embassy in Iran 1979. He was a hardliner. But he was a hardliner that basically morphed into what the reformists would look to and say, hey, if this guy was so good at putting in place such a repressive system, he might be good at removing it. We'll forgive you, as long as you can bring about gradual political change. You see, this is one of the things you need to remember about the Iranian people. In terms of their views, they're mostly, if they could vote in a free election, they'll vote out the Islamic Republic just like that. But they have these big sticks of the regime hanging over their heads, and they don't want to end up in a prison cell. Okay? And here comes along someone like Rafsanjani and the likes of Rouhani and Zarif. And these guys are not Democrats. Iranians appreciate that. But they're better alternative to the hardliners. And the hardliners have been engaged in this fight with the likes of Rafsanjani for years now. Today they're mourning him and calling him all sorts of wonderful things as a revolutionary father. But only a few months ago when Rafsanjani came out and he said something very simple and yet powerful, he said, look, the good people of the Revolutionary Guards, or the IRGC, all you're spending money and huff and puffing in the region, the Germans tried that. The Japanese tried that. What did that do for them? His argument was militarization is not the way forward. Economic development is the way forward. It was amazing to see the counter reaction. I mean, I'm just giving you some, this is from one of the IRGC tied media outlets, and boy, they have plenty of media outlets, part of their propaganda campaign. This here, and you tell me if they're right, allegedly shows you, the stars show you American military bases surrounding Iran. calling the old Ayatollah naive, saying, you know what? If we don't defend the nation's borders, then the Americans will come in and take over. Making the argument that they are the vanguards of not just the revolution, but of the nation. So let me take you, okay, there. Just needs a lot of love. Yes, okay. I don't even know where to aim at. So I wanted to show you, not a new rivalry. Okay, there it is, there's a bit of a delay. They're coming up, okay. These quotes are a few, 2 years or so old. But just read them and make up your mind. This is written and uttered in public discourse in Iran. That's Rouhani, the president, telling the head of the Revolution Guards, you guys, you better watch it, you're too provocative. The silly things you do down in the Persian Gulf, that's gonna start some sort of accidental war, and we all have to pay a price for it. In a nutshell, that's the message. And what does the counter argument come out as? Some do not show their true face or intentions. The argument being sort of boiling down to, you guys are basically doing the bidding of foreign powers in the case of Rouhani and Zarif, the West. I wanted to show you two individuals who are prominent, in the case of Nakdi up until recently very prominent. He's still there, although he changed role. The sort of narrative that they like to put out there for the Iranian people. This guy is Nakdi, a former head of the paramilitary force of the besieged. Just read what he says. We can change our foreign policy for sake of economy and becoming mere consumers of Western goods. What is he saying? He's saying, Rouhani, you want to turn Tehran into Dubai? You want that kind of a economy and that kind of a lifestyle? That's not what the 1979 revolution was all about. We're different. We're about the afterlife and so forth. That's the message, in many ways, for the home audience. And more in the region, you have Qasem Soleimani, who is the probably today, top three IRGC commanders in terms of influence and in many ways appeal. He does have a base, there's no doubt about it. He plays the nationalist card at home. It's all about Iran, Iran, Iran against these foreigners, be they Arabs, Turks, and whatever it might be. It's about Iran. At home, he plays the nationalist narrative. Abroad, when you see him run around in Iraq, he plays the sectarian message. It's very much a sectarian message. I am the savior of the Shias, and that's what he sells him and what he does in many ways to those Shia communities outside of Iran. I wanted to give you a little bit more taste of how this power struggle works. On this picture, we have Qasem Soleimani, you got Nakdi, and you got a guy called Amir Hussein Abdullahian. This fellow here, to the right, he is a long-term career diplomat. But everyone in the Iranian diplomatic corps will tell you he's IRGC's man in the foreign ministry to watch what the Iranian diplomats do, what the likes of Zarif are up to, and pass on the message to his real master, which is Qasem Soleimani. When Javad Zarif came in August of 2013 and took over as foreign minister, he replaced everyone from the Ahmadinejad era, except one fellow. And that was Abdullahian, okay? Why? Because he knows who backs him. And that gives you a taste for the balance of power. Just because Rouhani got a landslide doesn't mean he or his foreign minister can come in and say to the generals of the IRGC, to hell with you. He might want to say that, but for practical reasons, they've chosen not to take the fight to that level. When Zarif, about 2 years later, did replace Abdullahian as his deputy for Arab affairs, which basically meant Abdullahian was the fellow who would go to Damascus and Baghdad and so on. When Zarif replaced him, he was called all sorts of names in the Iranian parliament to be watched on live Iranian TV. Again, his reaction was quite telling. He had to come out and say, I'm proud of my brother Qasem Soleimani, Hassan Nasrallah, the head of the Lebanese Hezbollah, and Ramadan Shallah, the head of the Palestinian Islamic Jihad. That tells you Zarif, in some ways, took a step forward, but two steps back. You got to be careful. And that gives you a sense, again, of the balance of power.